This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book: Occult Science in India and Among the Ancients. Author: Louis Jacolliot. Year: 1919. Preface: We will lay aside, for the present, our inquiries into the general subject of the primitive civilizations of the Far East and the people who have sprung from the Brahmanic stock in the Old World, in order to publish the result of such researches as we have been able to make during our long residence in India, into the subject of occult science and the practices of those who have been initiated into the sect of the Petris, which is Sanskrit for spirits or ancestral shades. This is neither a doctrinal book nor a work of criticism. We are not called upon to decide either for or against the belief in spirits, either mediating or inspiring, which was held by all who had been initiated in the temples of antiquity, which is today the keystone of the philosophical and religious instruction of the Brahmins, and to which many of our Western thinkers and scientists seem inclined to assent. Being neither an advocate of this belief nor the opposite, we are, on that account, better able to write its history. An ardent partisan would have been too credulous and would have taken everything upon trust. A rabid opponent would have made it his business to disparage and discredit it. We shall give the words themselves and set forth things as they actually were. We shall interpret and explain the Agrauchada Parikshai, which is the philosophical compendium of the Hindu spiritists. We shall tell what we saw with our own eyes, and shall faithfully record such explanations as we received from the Brahmins. We shall pay particular attention to the phenomena which the fakirs produce at will, which some regard as the manifestations of a superior intervention, and others look upon as the result of a shrewd charlatanism. Upon this point, we have but a word to say. The facts which are simply magnetic are indisputable, extraordinary as they may seem. As to the facts which are purely spiritual, we were only able to explain those in which we participated, either as actor or spectator, upon the hypothesis that we were the victims of hallucination, unless we are willing to admit that there was an occult intervention. We shall describe things just as we saw them, without taking sides in the dispute. These doctrines were known to the Egyptians, to the Jewish Kabbalists, to the people of Finland, to the school of Alexandria, to Philo and his disciples, to the Gauls and to the early Christians, and as in the case of the Hindus, they set them apart for the use of those who had been initiated. As for the ancient Chaldeans, the practice of popular magic and sorcery seems to have been the utmost limit of their attainments in this direction. They have also given birth to a peculiar system of moral philosophy, whose place in the general scale of the metaphysical speculations of mankind we shall take occasion to point out. On the evening before the funeral esrata is to take place, or on the day itself, he who gives the esrata should with all due respect invite at least three Brahmins, such as those which have been already mentioned. The Brahmin who has been invited to the esrata of the spirit of the deceased should be entire master of his senses. He should not read the sacred scriptures, but only recite in a low tone the invocations which it is his office to utter, as he should do likewise, by whom the ceremony is performed. The ancestral spirits in the invisible state accompany the Brahmins who have been invited. They go with them, under an aerial form, and occupy a place by their side when they sit down. Manu Book E, Slokas 187-188-189. For a long time previous to their laying aside their mortal envelope, the souls which have practiced virtue, like those which inhabit the bodies of sannyasis and vanasprathas, anchorites and cenobites, acquire the faculty of conversing with souls that have gone before to the swarga. That is a sign that the series of their transmigrations upon earth is ended. The words of the ancient Bhagavata quoted in the proem of the Agrauchada Parikshai. Part 1. The Doctrine of the Petris and the Occult Sciences in India. Remember, my son, that there is only one God, the Sovereign Master and Principle of all things, and that the Brahmins should worship him in secret, but learn also that this is a mystery which should never be revealed to the vulgar herd. Otherwise great harm may befall you. Words spoken by the Brahmins upon receiving a candidate for initiation according to Vrihaspati. A. Creation. U. Preservation. M. Transformation. Chapter 1. The Initiated, at the Ancient Temples. It is not to the religion's writings of antiquity, such as the Vedas, the Zend Avesta, or the Bible, that we are to look for an accurate expression of the highest thought of the period. Written to be read, or rather chanted, in the temples upon great festivals, and framed mainly with a view to priestly domination, these books of the law were not intended to make known to common people the secrets of a science which occupies the leisure moments of the priests and initiated. "Bear in mind, my son," said the Hindu Brahmin to the neophyte, "that there is but one God, the sovereign master and principle of all things, and that every Brahmin should worship him in secret. Learn also that this is a mystery which should never be revealed to the vulgar herd. Otherwise great harm may befall you." We constantly meet with a similar prohibition in Manu. The primitive holy syllable, composed of the three letters A, U, M and comprising the Vedic Trinity, should be kept secret, Manu Bukshi, Sloka 265. These three letters symbolize all the initiatory secrets of the occult sciences. The Honavar or primordial germ is defined in the Zend Avesta as follows. "The pure, the holy, the prompt Honavar, I tell you plainly, a wise Zoroaster existed before the sky, before the sea, before the earth, before the animals, before the trees, before fire, son of Ormuzd, before the pure man, before the deus, before the whole world. It existed before there was any substance, should it not be explained in its essence to the Magi alone. The common people cannot even know of the existence of this venerated name, under penalty of death or madness." The ancient Kabbalists received a similar prohibition in the following passage from the Mishnah. "It is forbidden to explain the history of creation to two persons, or even the history of the Merkaba, or the history of the chariot, treating of the attributes of the unrevealed being, to one alone, unless he is a wise and intelligent man, in which case it is permitted to entrust to him the headings of the chapters." We are indebted to Mr. A. Frank, of the Institute, the eminent Hebraist, for an explanation of this curious passage of the Jewish Kabbalah. It will be seen that he confirms the opinion that we have just expressed, that an accurate interpretation of the beliefs of the sacerdotal castes and of the initiated is not to be found in the works the multitude were allowed to see. Evidently, this cannot refer to the text of Genesis or that of Ezekiel, where the prophet describes the vision he saw upon the banks of the Chebar. The whole scriptures, so to speak, were in everybody's mouth. From time immemorial, the most scrupulous observers of tradition had deemed it their duty to go through it at least once a year in the temple. Moses himself is constantly recommending the study of the law, by which he always means the Pentateuch. Esdras, after the return from the Babylonish captivity, read it aloud before the assembled people. The prohibition, which we have just quoted, cannot possibly refer to the history of the creation or to Ezekiel's vision, which anyone might seek to explain himself or to interpret to others. It refers to an interpretation, or rather to a known secretly taught doctrine, to a science whose forms as well as principles were fixed. Since we know how it was divided and that it was separated into chapters, each of which was preceded by a heading. Now it is to be noted that Ezekiel's vision is totally unlike this. It contains a single chapter and not several, the first one in the works attributed to that prophet. We see also that this secret doctrine contains two parts, which are not considered equally important, for one could be taught to two persons, while the whole of the other could never be divulged to any one person, even in case of compliance with the severity of the required conditions. If we are to believe Maimonides, who was a stranger to the Kabbalah, though he could not deny its existence, the first half, entitled The History of the Genesis or Creation, taught the science of nature. The second, entitled Merkaba, or The History of the Chariot, contained a treatise on theology. This is the accepted opinion of all Kabbalists. Here's another fact which shows the same thing, not less conclusively. The Rabbi Yochanan said one day to the Rabbi Eliezer, "Let me teach you the Merkaba." The latter answered him, "I am not old enough for that." When he had grown old, the Rabbi Yochanan died, and after a while the Rabbi Asi came in his turn. "Let me teach you the Merkaba," said he. He replied, "If I had thought myself worthy, I would already have learned it from the Rabbi Yochanan, your master." This shows that, in order to be initiated into the mysterious science of the Merkaba, an eminent position and exalted intellect were not all that were required. The candidate must also have reached a certain age, and even when that condition, which is also observed by modern Kabbalists, had been complied with, he did not always feel sure of possessing intellect or moral strength enough to assume the burden of the fearful secrets, which might endanger his religious convictions and the material observances of the law. Here's a curious example, taken from the Talmud itself, in allegorical terms, of which it afterward gives an explanation. According to the teachings of the masters, there were four who entered into the Garden of Delights, and their names are as follows: Ben Asai, Ben Zoma, Acher, and Rabbi Akiba. Ben Asai was over-inquisitive and lost his life. We may apply to him this verse of scripture: "What a precious thing in the eyes of the Lord is the death of his saints." Ben Zoma also looked, but he lost his reason. His fate justifies the sage's parable: "Did you find honey? Eat enough to suffice you, for fear that if you take too much, your stomach may reject it." Acher committed ravages among the plants. Lastly, Akiba entered quietly and came out quietly, for the saint whose name be blessed had said, "Spare this old man, he is worthy to serve with glory." It is hardly possible to construe this passage literally, or to suppose that it refers to a material vision of the splendors of another life, for there is no example in the Talmud of the use of the very mystical language here employed. As applied to paradise, how can we allow, besides, that the contemplation during life of the powers who wait upon the elect in heaven should have caused the loss of life or reason, as in the case of two of the persons mentioned in this legend? We agree with the most esteemed authorities of the synagogue that the Garden of Delights, which the four doctors entered, was merely that mysterious science before spoken of, terrible for weak intellects since it often leads to insanity. We have a reason for giving this long extract in full. Apart from the support it lends to our theory, it enables us to show the intimate connection that exists between the doctrines of the ancient Jewish Kabbalists and those of the Hindu votaries of the Pitris, or spirits. The latter, indeed, as we shall soon see, only admitted old men to initiation, and their scientific book, the Agrauchata Parikshai, as well as the books of the early Kabbalists, the account of the creation and the Merkaba, and finally, the Zohar, is divided into three parts, treating: first, of the attributes of God; second, of the world; third, of the human soul. In a fourth part, the Agrauchata Parikshai sets forth the relations of universal souls to each other, and indicates the modes of evocation by means whereof the Pitris may be induced to manifest themselves to men, and teach them everlasting truth, according to the higher or lower degree of perfection to which they may, individually, have attained through their good works. The works of the Jewish Kabbalah, and especially the Zohar, do not contain this fourth part. Not that the Kabbalists deny that these disembodied souls can enter into relations with those souls which have not yet laid aside their fleshly envelope. The evocation of the soul of Samuel by the witch of Endor in the presence of Saul, as well as of numerous other biblical apparitions, are sufficient to show that the belief existed. But they made it the subject of an initiation, and these terrible secrets were only taught by word of mouth in the mysterious recesses of the temples. It was not the study of God or the world which drove weak intellects into madness, as mentioned in that passage of the Talmud before spoken of, but rather the Kabbalistic practice of evocation in the supreme initiation. "Whoever," says the Talmud, has learned this secret and keeps it vigilantly in a pure heart, may reckon upon the love of God and the favor of men. His name inspires respect. His science is in no danger of being forgotten, and he is the heir of two worlds that we live in and the world to come. How can we know the secrets of the world to come, except by communicating with those who live there already? We shall see that the Zohar of the Kabbalists and the Agrauchada, Parikshai of the Hindus, profess the same ideas as to the primordial germ or God, the world and the soul. We incline, therefore, to the belief that we are correct in thinking that the practices openly taught by the Hindus were also taught, so to speak, by word of mouth, by the ancient Thanaims of Judaism. We find Indian pagodas, indeed, where the fourth part of the Agrauchada is separated from the three others, and forms, so to speak, a book by itself, which would lead to the supposition that it was revealed last and only to a small number of adepts. We may add that the Kabbalists of Judea and the votaries of the Petris in India use the same expression to designate the adepts of the occult sciences. He has entered the Garden of Delights. No doctrinal work upon these matters has come down to us from the Egyptians or the ancient Chaldeans, but the fragmentary inscriptions we do possess show that a higher initiation also existed among both. The great name, the mysterious name, the supreme name, which was known only to Ea, was never to be uttered. Thus, there is no doubt that the initiation in ancient times did not consist of a knowledge of the great religious works of the age, such as the Vedas, the Zend Avesta, the Bible, etc., which everybody studied, but rather of the admission of a small number of priests and savants to an occult science which had its genesis, its theology, its philosophy, and its peculiar practices, which it was forbidden to reveal to the vulgar herd. India has preserved all the manuscript treasures of its primitive civilization. The initiated have never abandoned any of their old beliefs or practices. It is, therefore, in our power to lift the veil completely from the Brahmanich initiations. After comparing the philosophical doctrines of the adepts of the Petris with those of the Jewish Kabbalists, we shall go on to show the relations or connection between the initiated of other nations and the initiated of the Hindu pagodas. Chapter 2. The Brahmins. Before touching upon the main point of our subject, it may not be amiss to say a few words about the Brahmins. We do not propose, however, to raise the question of their real origin, which has been the subject of so much scientific controversy. According to some, who have certain ethnological theories of their own to support, they came from the sterile and desolate plains, which extend from the eastern shore of the Caspian Sea to the banks of the Oxus. According to others, who agree with the sacred books and pundits of India upon that point, they originated in the country comprised between the Ganges and the Indus on the one side, and the Godavari and the Krishna on the other. With regard to the former hypothesis, we have said elsewhere, such a theory seems singular to say the least, when it is known that this country, which is held out to us as the cradle of the ancient Hindu race, does not possess a ruin, a tradition, a trace which can furnish an ethnological foundation for such an opinion. This land, which is said to have produced the most astonishing civilization of ancient times, has not a monument or tradition of any sort to show for itself. It would be quite as logical, indeed, to make the Aryans or Brahmins originate in the sandy deserts of Sahara. According to the second theory, the Brahmins came originally from the plains of central Hindustan. This opinion has historic and geographical truth in its favor, as well as the authority of all the learned pundits and of Manu, whose celebrated words are well known. Kurukshetra, Matsya and the land of Bauchala, which is also called Kaya Kabja, the mountain of the Virgin, and Saraswaka, also called Mathura, form the country adjacent to that of Brahmavarta, the country of virtuous men, or in other words, of the Brahmins. These countries are included in the quadrilateral formed by the four rivers just named. We shall not dwell upon this point further, however, as it is not our intention to discuss ethnological problems in the present work, but rather to set forth and elucidate religious conceptions. Manu, the legislator who sprang from the temples of India, attributes to the Brahmins a divine origin. For the propagation of the human race, from his mouth, from his arm, from his thigh, from his foot, the sovereign master produced the Brahmin priest, the ekshatriya king, the vaisya merchant, the sudra slave. By his origin, which he derives from the most noble member because he was the firstborn, because he possesses the holy scriptures, the Brahmin is, by right, the lord of all creation. Everything that the world contains is the Brahmin's property. By his primogeniture and his eminent birth, he is entitled to everything that exists. The Brahmin eats nothing that does not belong to him, receives no garment that is not already his, and bestows no alms from the property of others that does not also belong to him. It is through the Brahmin's generosity that other men enjoy the goods of this world. Manu, Book I. This is the original source of the doctrine of divine right. For several thousand years, the Brahmins, priests, ruled over India without dispute. The kings, or as we might rather say, the chiefs, were only their agents. The mass of the people, like a flock of sheep, maintained the upper classes in luxury and idleness by their labor. In the temples, which were vast sacerdotal storehouses filled with the treasures accumulated by the toil of the laboring classes, the priests appeared before the eyes of the assembled multitude, clad in gorgeous vestments. Kneeling before idols of wood, granite, or bronze, of their own contrivance, they set an example of the most absurd superstition. Their principal motive in the performance of their religious duties was the maintenance of their temporal supremacy, and when the sacrifices were over, the vaisya and sudra returned to their tasks, the chiefs to their pleasures, and the priests to their mysterious abodes, where they engaged in the study of the sciences and of the highest philosophical and religious speculations. The hour came when the ekshatriyas, or kings, made use of the people to throw off the theocratic yoke, but when they had conquered the priests and assumed the title of lords of creation, they abandoned their late allies and said to the Brahmins, "Preach to the people the doctrine that we are the elect of God, and we will give you all the wealth and privileges you desire." That was the basis of their agreement, and for 20,000 years and more, the sudra, the servum pecus, the people, have never been able to break it up. Reduced to a purely religious role, the Brahmins used all their power to keep the multitude in ignorance and subserviency. Mistrustful lest some members of their order more ambitious than the rest might, one day or other, seek to further their own ends by stirring up the lower classes to revolt, they place the secret of their religious belief, of their principles, of their sciences, under the shield of an initiatory ceremony, to the highest grade of which those only were admitted who had completed a novitiate of 40 years of passive obedience. There were 3 degrees of initiation. The first included all the Brahmins of the popular cult, or those who officiated at the pagodas, whose business it was to work upon the credulity of the multitude. They were taught to comment upon the 3 first books of the Vedas, to direct the religious ceremonies, and to perform sacrifices. The Brahmins of the first degree were in constant communication with the people. They were its immediate directors, its gurus. The second degree included the exorcists, the soothsayers, the prophets, and the evocators of spirits, whose business it was, in times of difficulty, to act upon the imagination of the masses through supernatural phenomena. They read and commented upon the Atharva Veda, which was a collection of magical conjurations. In the third degree, the Brahmins had no direct relations with the populace, the study of all the physical and supernatural forces of the universe being their only occupation. They never appeared outside except through awe-inspiring phenomena, which spectators were not allowed to scrutinize too closely. According to the celebrated Sanskrit Sorites, the gods and spirits were at their disposition. Devadinam jagat sarvam. Mantradinam ta devada. Tan mantram brahmanadinam. Brahmana mama devada. Everything that exists is in the power of the gods. The gods are in the power of magical conjurations. Magical conjurations are in the power of the Brahmins. Therefore, the gods are in the power of the Brahmins. It was impossible to arrive at the highest degree without having passed through the first two, where a process of weeding, as it were, was constantly going on, having regard to the ability and intelligence of the candidates. It would have been impossible to conceive of a more effective instrument of social conservatism, and our modern doctrinaires may well regard it with a jealous eye. Those who were too intelligent, or who were not sufficiently amenable to discipline, owing to their inflexibility of character, were soon lost amid the crowd of bigots and fanatics of the first degree, who were as submissive and free from ambition as could possibly be desired. The lower clergy, if we may be allowed to use the expression, were not much above the level of the rest of the Hindu people, whose superstitions they shared, and whom they taught perhaps honestly. Absorbed in the ordinary observances of religious worship, that independence of mind which usually accompanies knowledge was not to be apprehended from them. It was not until 20 years had elapsed that promotion was possible from the first to the second degree, where the veil of the occult sciences first began to be uplifted, and the same period of time was necessary in order to surmount the mysterious barriers of the third degree. That class of initiates studied the Agrauchata Parikshai, or the Book of Spirits. Above this last degree of initiation was the Supreme Council, under the presidency of the Brahmatma, or supreme chief of all those who had been initiated. Only a Brahmin who had passed his 80th year could exercise this pontificate. He was the sole keeper of the elevated formula, which included a summary of all knowledge and was contained in the three mystic letters A. U. M., signifying creation, preservation, transformation. He commented upon them only in the presence of the initiate. Residing in an immense palace surrounded by 21 walls, the Brahmatma showed himself to the multitude only once a year, encompassed with such pomp and pageantry that his appearance impressed the imagination of all who saw him, as though they had been in the presence of a god. The common people thought that he was immortal. In fact, in order to maintain this belief in the minds of the masses, the death of the Brahmatma and the election of his successor were kept profoundly secret and were never known by them. Everything occurred in the silence of the temples, and those who had been initiated in the third degree alone took part in his election. Only those who were members of the Supreme Council were eligible. Whoever among those who have been initiated into the third degree shall reveal to a profane person a single one of the truths, a single one of the secrets entrusted to his keeping, shall be put to death. The recipient of the revelation met a similar fate. Finally, to crown the whole system, there existed a higher word than the mysterious monosyllable A-U-M, which made him who possessed the clue to it almost it equal to Brahma himself. The Brahmatma alone possessed it and transmitted it to his successor in a sealed box. Even now, when the Brahmanic authority has sunk so low before Mongol and European invasion, when every pagoda lias its Brahmatma, this unknown word has been revealed to no human power and has been kept a profound secret. It was engraved in a golden triangle and carefully kept in a sanctuary of the temple of Asgartha, of which the Brahmatma alone had the keys. For this reason also he wore, upon his tiara, two crossed keys upheld by two kneeling Brahmins, as a sign of the precious deposit which had been entrusted to his care. This word and triangle were also engraved upon the gem of the ring, which this religious chief wore as a sign of his dignity. It was also set in a golden sun, which stood upon the altar upon which the Supreme Pontiff offered every morning the sacrifice of the Sarvameda, or sacrifice to all the forces of nature. At the death of the Brahmatma, his body was burned upon a golden tripod, and his ashes secretly thrown into the Ganges. If, in spite of every precaution, a report of his death was bruited abroad, the priests adroitly spread abroad the rumor that the Supreme Chief had ascended for a time to Swarga, heaven, in the smoke of the sacrifice, but would soon return to the earth. Numerous revolutions have so thoroughly disturbed the social and religious condition of India that Brahmanism no longer possesses any supreme chief. Each pagoda has its 3 degrees of initiation and its own private Brahmatma.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.